Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions, putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Understanding God's Loving Laws group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the Permanence Principles presentation, Jesus briefly summarizes God's principles of permanence that govern the operation of God's laws, gives examples of the way these principles are built into God's laws, and answers audience questions about the principles. Recorded on the 20th of November 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
Our plan today, just to say a bit of housekeeping things before we begin, our plan today is to, obviously we need to just rejig the program. So what we're going to do is do permanence principles before the lunch. We'll have lunch and then we'll do scope principles straight after lunch. And then we'll do a shortened version of human law comparison and a very shortened version of the review and homework. And it might even be just looking at the homework. Does that make sense? Just to keep us on time for today. Obviously, you will also have the opportunity to see the longer versions from the previous group, because we did do the longer versions in the previous group. So here we are. We're at this topic of permanence principles. Another fascinating topic. So let's examine a summary of these principles. So permanence principles mean that all creation can rely on permanent law. Now this is permanent law, right? By ensuring laws are unchangeable, consistent, permanent, and self-enforcing. So once a law is created, it is unchangeable. But it still allows for new laws to be created. But once the law is created, it's unchangeable. It works all the time under the same circumstance. Right? It's consistent, permanent, self-enforcing. And we've already talked about self-enforcing, haven't we? The laws through economy need to be self-enforcing, automated. Otherwise, it'd be very, very hard to police. They're structured, verifiable, and mathematical. So many of these have hierarchy. They have structure. They are verifiable in the sense that you can measure them using a variety of different methods. And in fact, if you examine every method of investigation that a human can actually be involved in, they will usually end up with the same conclusion, even. So, and that's because they're so structured and verifiable and injected into each method of examination of the universe. So if you're interested in art, you'll end up understanding a lot of things. If you're interested in music, you'll end up understanding a lot of things. If you're interested in science, same. If you're interested in maths, the same. If you're interested in emotions, you end up with the same result in the end. If you know what I mean? It's like, so what it does is it enables us to get from a wide variety of fields of expertise to be able to come to the same or similar conclusions. Which actually means that you can be interested in one area of expertise but end up with the same conclusions that another person in another area of expertise has arrived at independently. So this gives us lots of opportunity to discover the law itself and the permanence of it through these different permanence principles being injected into all different areas of life. Mathematical, of course, we've already discussed, haven't we? God's method of communication, of truth. So they're measurable, quantifiable, and observable. So we can measure them, we can observe them. Now, when we say observe them, what we mean is that all laws are observed either by the level of the soul at the level it is in comparison to the level of the law. So what does that mean? So our physical body and our physical body is on the earth in the physical universe, right? So we're on the earth. So our physical body has the ability to measure the physical things. Does that make sense? The physical operation of things. We can measure it through observation. We can quantify the observations, develop mathematical formulas for the observations. But those observations will all be physical observations that our eyes and our senses, our ears and so forth, physical body senses can actually see, feel, touch, but also, and taste, of course, and those kind of things, but also we can begin, even in our physical form, to measure things that we can't see but we can feel. So, for example, wind, which is actually the result of air pressure differentials, right, can be measured because we can feel that that's a bigger pressure, and then we can create a device, a little fan thing to, you know, a turbine, what do they call themselves? An anemometer, yes. An anemometer to measure the velocity of the wind, right, can be also created. So we can actually use physical measuring devices to measure some of the things we can't see but we can feel, or things that we can't see but we can hear, and so forth. So you see, many of the senses allow us to have one thing and not the other being able to be measured. And we create devices that can measure these things as well, so in the physical. Now, in the spheres around the Earth, of which there are eventually, like we know, there's 35 of them before you hit the soul, the transition, which is the soul space, which is outside of this universe and in another universe, and we'll talk about that later. What those spheres, you can measure things with the spirit body. So you've got a spirit body here, and that can measure things in those spheres. But it's dependent upon the condition of the body in regards to love as to how much you can measure. But you can still measure it. The potential is there built into the spirit body to measure it, but the condition of love of the soul depends on how much of it you can measure. Does that make sense? Now, here in the soul union state, the soul has got an enhanced or a superset of senses. So instead of just having sight, hearing, touch and so forth, it's got all of those senses, plus it also has a larger variety of those senses. In other words, instead of just seeing the visible spectrum, it can see the invisible spectrum to the human eye in the spirit body. So you can actually see the invisible spectrum in the spirit body that you couldn't see in your physical body. So every higher creation has a higher set of senses, but it's still able to measure and quantify and observe its surroundings using those senses, just like we can use our physical senses to measure, quantify and quantify our surroundings. Does that make sense to you? So that's what that means, that everything is actually observable. Now, this makes everything safe and predictable. And in fact, without permanence, everything would be completely unsafe and completely unpredictable, which wouldn't be very loving if you think about it, because it means, as we pointed out before yesterday, you do one thing one day and you end up with a certain result, and you do the same thing the next day and it kills you. You know, these kind of problems exist if we don't have permanence. So permanence creates the safety and predictability of the universe. Of course, you inject the human will into it, now everything's a bit unsafe and unpredictable, isn't it? Because now you're dependent on people making really strange choices and, you know, driven by unloving emotions and so forth, and fears and all sorts of things that God never created, but they, the humans, created. And as a result of that, there's a greater degree of unpredictability. But still, everything is tending towards predictability, because all of God's laws are still trying to correct the humans that have created their own creations outside of this predictable state that God's created. So that's the permanence principles. What we'd like to do, we're going to do the same thing as we did yesterday, in that we will go straight to your questions rather than going through my examples. If you want to see my examples, well, we listed most of them in the first group, so you have an opportunity to go over them in the first group. All right, so can we start with Fab first? So microphone runners, please. Fab on this side. And Wayne, sure, on this side. Thanks, Wayne. So Wayne down here. Thanks, Fab. We start with
first one or second one? I think
it's two. It's your first one on the list,
mate. Okay, this principle applies to every one of God's creations. Can you please give an example with things that can't be seen, like frequencies and sound waves, for example?
Yes. I think they're pretty self-evident, aren't they? Like frequencies and sound waves. Do all of you understand what we mean by a frequency? Oh, okay, maybe they're not so self-evident. Okay. As any musician would know, sound is produced by something vibrating, is it not?
Yes.
Yes? And the vibrational frequency of the sound determines the pitch of the sound. In other words, whether the sound is higher or lower. And that the pitch of sound is measured as what's called frequency. And frequency is drawn like a vibrational wave. So, like that. Now, frequencies all have what is called amplitude. And the number of vibrations per period determines the frequency. The cycles per second of the wave. Now, it's very interesting in music because each note has a mathematical structure with regard to its frequency. So the relationship, and our ears, interestingly enough, of the human body, are attuned to very minute errors in the mathematical structure of the frequency. Right? So inbuilt inside of your brain is a very clever system that can hear even right down to what's called 1 hertz or 1 cycle per second. It can hear when a frequency is out of mathematical harmony. Right? So, and a person who's been doing music for many, many years, of course, becomes, and particularly people like opera singers and so forth, they get the frequency smack on the exact frequency of the wave that they have to generate. So they have such good control between their ear and their vocal cords that they can actually get the frequency to be exactly right so that it sounds good to your ear. Isn't that interesting? So there's an example of permanence. Obviously, inside of and this is permanent inside of every person. So even though you're all individuals, inside of all of you is this same measuring instrument that's permanent, that's structured exactly the same way and permanent. And it means that you can hear the differences. And once you train yourself, or some people have a natural affinity to it, obviously, and some people are spirit over cloak to have a natural affinity too. But once you train yourself, or you're spirit over cloaked and therefore help some spirit help to do it, you can get yourself exactly right on the frequency that you speak or sing compared to the frequency you hear. Right? And this actually, if you think about it, requires that the human body, all of our human bodies, although we have a completely different genetic genome, determining what colour eyes we have, what colour ears we have, all these different factors, 3 billion of them, that tells you that 90% of that genome is actually sort of unchangeable. There's nothing you can do about it. And one of these things is what happens with frequency, in terms of the way the body simulates frequencies. And that then makes all of us the same. We all hear the same sound at the same frequency and determine it to be the same note. If we're trained, we can determine it to be the same note. And we hear it the same. So that's permanence in relation to the generation of sound and the human body's response to it. Yeah. That makes sense? Yeah. So that's an example of how... And sound, of course, is not something we can see, but we still believe in it, right? Because we can hear it. So it's not right to say, I only believe in what I see, because that means that if somebody says that, that means they don't believe in music at all. And I've never met anybody who doesn't believe there's such a thing as music. So the reality is they only believe what their senses can reveal. Now, the only problem with that is, as I've discussed in the previous diagram, your senses are capable of development into revealing new things, but only through development in love. They are capable of further development. So And that's a built-in law too that's permanent. We all have this built-in law that says if you develop something, you will receive new abilities to therefore measure and observe, right? That's a part of the permanence of the law, that development is a part of the permanence. In other words, if you allow development, you will get new function. And that is actually a part of the permanence principle. That makes development permanent. It makes change permanent, right? And by having those principles inbuilt into the functionality of all laws. Yeah. Does that make sense, Fab?
Yeah, it's good. Yeah.
Thanks. Good example. Wayne, can we go to you?
Can the laws results be measured, quantified and observed with our current knowledge of maths, or are they yet to be discovered forms of maths?
Exactly. Now, this obviously means that, like, in my current state, with my current knowledge and my current mathematical understanding, obviously I have limitations in my methods of observation. But that doesn't mean that God created everything unobservable. God actually created everything to be observable, even right down to your thoughts. In the spirit world, you can observe the thought. You can observe its seed, and you can observe it being transmitted to another person. And you can see the little packet hit them, bang, huh? And there it goes. Like the observation of the thought is happening. You follow? Now, in our physical state, we're capable of observing them too, and even of reading them if we want to. But most of us haven't developed that ability, so we can't do it. That's what they call telepathy, right? Right? The reality is you can develop the ability, but you have to know the laws behind how to develop the ability. But the ability is there, ready to be ready to be engaged, as long as you engage the development required to get to have that ability. Now, in the spirit world, because it's a natural form of the abilities of the spirit body, within a few years after being in the spirit world, particularly after you exit the first sphere and into the second sphere, you start observing packets. But you can't read them. You can only read the packets that are at the same level of development as you are. Right? So if Corny's in the fifth sphere and I'm in the first sphere and Corny has a packet come out of him and goes off somewhere, I'm going, what the devil did he say? What's going on, man? I can't read that one, right? But if I'm in the seventh sphere and Corny's in the fifth sphere, read it straight away. I know exactly what's going on. Does that make sense? And that's a factor of permanence too. The reality is everybody can do it, but it's built in, but it's dependent on development, which is principle we covered yesterday. So you have these. Remember, every thought is just an energy. Every emotion you have is just an energy in motion. Remember, God's universe measures energy in motion. Now, God is the most finely tuned energetic system, right? God has the most finely tuned energetic system. Being infinite, has an infinitesimally small, he can observe every tiny, tiny little energy change infinite to the infinitesimally small. So what that means is a hair drops out of your head and he knows it happened. That's literally true. He knows it happened, right? Because he measures the energy that was lost from the body by that thing occurring. So that he can measure it right down to these tiny little fine-tuned areas of what's going on inside of you with your energy systems. So, like, is it therefore, now we can start to understand, well, wow, that means that every thought I have, God knows. Every feeling I have, God knows. Anything that happens to my body, any little flake of skin that falls off, any little cell that goes, any little, whatever happens, God knows, because he's measuring every little energetic system that's going on, physical, spiritual, as well as soul-based. So he knows exactly what's going on with every single thing, right? He doesn't need to ask you, right? He knows. And the more you get in tune with God and the more you receive of God's love, the more you don't have to ask, because you already know. So in the spirit world, it's really interesting because after a while in your development, it's dependent on development again, based on the permanence principle, you get to the stage where you can actually measure what people know, what's happened to them, right down to their birth, right down to their conception even. You can measure it because the record is there in their soul. And as long as you have the development to see it, you can see it. So you don't have to ask them, what happened when you were 2? What happened when you were 5? You already know. You can walk up to a person and know them straight away. Right? And this is something that many of it confuses you with me, for many of you already. There's a large degree of you that I already know. Right? Now, I don't know everything because my development at this stage does not allow it. But I know a lot more than oftentimes you know even about yourself. And when you get the spirit world and you get with some celestial spirits, they'll be pointing out things. You go, what? I didn't know that. But it's true. Yeah, yeah. And you might argue with them initially, right? But eventually you'll work out that it is true. Yeah. Okay. Laurie, you would like to ask a part of that.
So when we release an emotion, is the measurement, is the mathematical measurement different? So then how would an advanced spirit be able to know that that packet of energy was there when it's been released?
Well, you're starting to get too complicated now because the reality is, remember, there's two forms of communication. One is mathematical and one is emotional. So if I am sensitive emotionally, can you see it's a lot easier than have to work out the mathematical formula, process what's just gone on in Laura, get that thing going on. I go back, yeah, that mathematical formula means she's
okay.
Angry. She's angry,
get it.
You know, like, or whatever. But the reality is there is a mathematical formula defining angry, and the intensity or the amplitude of the anger will obviously, but there is the frequency of your anger, there is a emotional frequency, you could say, to every single emotion, and that is measurable and it's quantifiable for every person. It's identical, just like it is with music. Right? Just like a sound wave is measurable and quantifiable as to its pitch or its frequency, so too are your emotions quantifiable through frequencies, right? But they're different kinds of frequencies. They're not frequencies of sound. They're just frequencies of feelings. But there's also an amplitude to it, how intense it is, how big it is, you know. So I can say, yeah, Laura's angry and she's really angry, you know, or Laura's angry, but it's just a little bit, you know, it's not too much. But all of those things are mathematical quantifiable. Now, when we went back to Wayne's question, he said, without current knowledge of mass, or yet to be discovered forms of math, how do we quantify them? Well, obviously that's difficult, isn't it? Because you need to firstly discover the mathematics, or you need to have the emotional sensitivity, one of the two, because they are the two measuring instruments. You need to have one or the other developed in order to quantify them. And so this is why for many of you, you find that I can quantify some feelings in you and you start crying, but you didn't quantify those feelings before that point. And that's because the development inside of you didn't allow the quantifying of that particular emotion. Does that make sense? Yeah. But it's still permanent. It's still there. The laws are still there. Anybody who engages those laws can engage the laws and measure it. It's just that, do I know the law? If I don't know the law, then I can't engage. Right? And this is the advantage of knowing law. When you know the law, you can then use it to your advantage. Yeah? And therefore, you can know people just as you meet them. You don't have to ask long. You know, this, you know how sometimes Mary and I do this quite a lot still, where we sit down with a person. A lot of times we do it now because we want to have some interaction with a person that is engaging. A lot of the times we know some of, you know, for myself, a lot of the answers, but you know, we engage you and ask you questions. What happened this in your life, and what happened there in your life, and what did you hear in your life, and what did you do there in your life, and so forth. That's usually how you get to know somebody, right? Well, in the spirit world, as the higher you get in the spirit world, the more the lower spirits, you already know what happened in their life. You know exactly what's happened in the life. You read it not only in their outward demeanor, but also as a part of their soul experience. And the soul experience of every single person is kept as a record that you can actually see in the spirit form if you have development. Yeah. Okay, let's move on. Can we go to Phoebe. Where are you, Phoebe? There, on this side. And I'll try and find somebody on this side. Eloisa, can we have you on this side? Yep. Thank you. So let's start with Phoebe.
Okay. If God feels love must be permanent, is it possible for a human to love someone or something and stop? Or does that mean that they never loved them in the first place?
Yes. Remember, these principles are God's principles. They're not our principles. So that's the first thing to consider. God's principles are that God's love is permanent. So once you've received God's love, you cannot lose it. Like, God doesn't say, I decided I'm not going to love you anymore. Right? But humans frequently do that, don't they? But as you grow towards the sixth dimension of the spirit world, so the perfect natural human, you get to the point where you automatically have that principled love for every person, and now that is permanent within you. Does that make sense? So the more you approach God's condition, the more permanence your love has. So love on earth is very impermanent, isn't it? Yeah. Yeah. And that's caused us to have a lot of fear, actually, hasn't it? Like, many of you are afraid to take risks, because if you take a risk and fall in love with somebody and then they reject you or something, or they initially loved you and then they reject you, that hurts you. And because of the impermanence of that love, you now feel hurt, right? Well, that can't happen with God. So many of you are afraid of loving God or afraid of receiving God's love for the same reason you're afraid of loving people. But actually, the rules don't apply, because people have their own will and desire. People don't have to have permanence with love, whereas God does. Right? So the reality is that God's love is permanent. You've asked, is it possible for a human to love something and stop? Yes, it is, because humans can choose to be out of harmony with the principle of permanence.
So is it still love that they're feeling, if it can stop?
Well, while they're in that emotion, certainly the emotional frequency of love is there. Does that make sense? It's measurable while it's there, but they can stop. They're not like God, who does not stop loving. Does that make sense? When you become at one with God, though, now it's different, because you now can't stop loving. Right? Even if sometimes you want to, you can't. Right? Why would you want to stop loving? Well, you know, sometimes people treat you pretty badly, particularly on earth, but you still can't stop loving them once you're at one with God. Right? But on earth, without that love, and this is something that's said quite, if those of you who've read the Paget messages fairly well, you'll notice in the Paget messages it does talk about how human love is very impermanent and actually fickle, not very important. You know, not treated as very important, and it's certainly hard to rely upon as a result of its impermanence. But impermanence in love is a choice. It's not anything other than a choice. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Good question. And we were over at Eloisa, weren't we?
So which number?
Question one, thanks, Eloisa.
God desires humans to discover truth through their desires. How does this relate to consistency?
Well, the law, the permanence principles, dictate that if you have a desire, then the law will respond.
Yep.
Does that make sense?
Yep.
It doesn't mean that your desires have to be consistent. It just is measuring your desire, and the law, the permanence principles in the law, will say it will always respond to desire. There's another set of permanence principles in the will-based law principles, and that is the law will always respond to your current will. Right? So there are laws that God has created, and permanence is the structure, is the basis or the foundation for these laws, that all mean that if your will can be measured, your desire can be measured, and now the law can respond consistently to the level of desire, the amplitude of desire, and the frequency, the type of desire that you have. Does that make sense? Yeah.
So the law is completely permanent, but my desire is the thing that comes and goes, which is going to create the outcomes.
Yes, which makes everything look not so permanent.
Yeah.
Right? But the reality is the law is still permanent.
Yeah.
It's just our desire is the thing that's changing, and therefore it seems like everything is a bit more fickle, yeah. But the reality is it's our desire that's fickle. It's not anything yeah. else.
Yeah.
You follow?
Yeah, yeah. I do. Thank you.
And this is the case with the harmony with all of these principles. Every time you're out of harmony with one of the principles, what you really demonstrate is a fickleness in your current soul state or a fickleness in your desire, which means that there's a variation between your current soul state and the law, and the law is going to permanently respond the same way depending on what kind of desire you have and what direction it's being exercised in. Does that make sense? So the law is still permanent, but the response seems to be yeah. impermanent because of the variations that occur in the human soul.
Okay. Yep. And is this why you end up sort of feeling a lot better with consistency, the kind of stronger the desire you have?
Yes. Yes. Thanks. And the stronger you understand the relationship between will, which is your current state, desire, which is your aspired to future state, your faith state.
Yes.
And if you recognize the relationship between these things, then everything becomes permanent. Everything, you can predict what's going to happen under these particular principles.
Could you explain that just a little more?
Yes. I know that if I love you, right, no matter how you are now, you might be angry with me, like some of the ladies who have just left are going to be quite angry with me,
yeah.
and so forth. I know that if I love you consistently, in the end result, you'll know that I love you.
Yeah.
It might not be today, and it might not be tomorrow, and it might not be 2 months' time, or even 5 years or 10 years' time. It might not even be in the next 1,000 years, but sooner or later, you realise that I did love you.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yep. Yep. Definitely.
Your realization will be based upon what you allow happen in your own soul.
Yeah.
But it doesn't mean that my love for you wasn't permanent or was fickle. Mm.
Yeah, it's just I didn't recognize it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Yep. Thank you very much.
Good-o. Now, Kerry, where are you? Can we have Kerry next? And on the other side, could we have Luli, your question number two, Luli? Kerry, your one question, yeah.
Yeah. With every effect of the same kind, for example, pain in my right shoulder, is that the exact same cause, same unloving action and or suppressed emotion in every single person?
Yes.
Yep.
Wow.
Yeah.
You imagine if we could work out what it was, you could then apply it to every single person on the planet who has a pain in their right shoulder. Same goes with any single accident that's identical. Same goes with every single disease that's identical. Same goes with every single sickness that's identical. Breakage yeah. of any bone that's identical. It's all identical causes. Right? Permanence allows cause and effect to be measured.
Mm.
And this is a very... If the medical profession understood this, and started doing experiments with this, within a very short amount of time, they'd actually be able to see who is going to get cancer, not based upon, you know, looking at genetics and all those things, because they all have factors, of course, but by looking at the exact emotion. If you could have a measuring thing that measures an emotion that causes cancer of a certain type, you imagine the benefit of that. You could say, you could dial the dial, go, is there going to get bowel cancer, breast cancer, blah, 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 right? You dial the dial and whoop, resonance in the body of the person, bang, yep, you're going to get it for sure. And what emotion is it that caused it? Well, that emotion is the resonance emotion of anger suppressed through this desire for an addiction to be met in a certain way. And so you can measure that and tell them what the actual cause is. Yeah. So the doctor of the future could actually not be, you know, pounding them with you know, x-rays or you know, radiation to get rid of it, but rather looking at measuring and looking at the results of the measurements to see specifically what the emotion is, telling them what the emotion is that need to be addressed, and then even creating a program that's specifically designed to access that emotion.
Mm.
to either make them angry or make them this or make them that, you know, just to help them get into that particular emotion that's going to need to be released to release that particular sickness or disease from them.
Yep.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So this is where you can see a lot of experimentation needs to occur, but knowing that one truth of permanence is that every single thing that happens in the body at the same location, is the same cause. Now, this gives us a wonderful way of being able to actually repair, even on a physical level, repair a lot of the problems that we're experiencing in the medical profession right now in terms of determining sickness and disease and what the causes are. Kerry? Yeah?
Just to add a little bit to that. So say if it was a different injury, shoulder injury,
yep,
but one person had, you know, lower down, might have been muscle, and the other one had a ligament or bone.
All different?
All different.
All has a different cause.
Yep. Okay.
Yep.
Cool. Thanks.
Yeah, it's real cool. As a lot of these things are. Lily, your turn now.
Second question,
thank you.
How do the permanence principles fit with the fact that new laws are being created all the time?
Yes, so that's a good question, isn't it, of logic? We need to look at this logically. How can new laws be created all the time, but the laws that are created be permanent? Well, can you see now from my previous description that is possible, that once the law is created, that there's a permanence even in that scope, which is the next principle you look at, you'll actually see that scope defines that new laws are possible to be created, but when they are created, they'll be identical. So you could say the beauty of this is that potentials are now inbuilt permanence. So once a potential is created, and that even the creation of that potential is quantifiable, predictable, and so forth, once that potential is created, then the outcome of that potential, once it's engaged, is also permanent. Now, this is interesting with regard to things like scientific discoveries in the past. Like, for example, you know the periodic table, the chemical, you know, elemental periodic table. You've got, what is it, nearly 120 elements now, I think it is, 118, that they've synthesized even. But even the ones that they've synthesized that are actually not naturally on this earth, they knew would be able to be synthesized because it was predictable from the other parts of the table, right? So when they first discovered, the very first people who discovered, I think it was way back in the 18th century at this day, that first discovered the first elemental principles. I don't know if you know what I mean by the periodic table. It's a table of chemical composition of elements and the electronic and protonic composition of elements. And, you know, when it was first discovered, it was only a few basic elements that could be put on the table. So hydrogen, carbon, some of the more common elements, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, phosphorus, and those kind of elements. Potassium and other elements came along. But then there was a whole heap of elements that nobody had yet really found or could define. But the man who actually came up with the table knew that they would be mathematically available because mathematically they would fit in a certain area on the table, right? And sure enough, years later, sometimes some of the cases after his death, the very things he predicted to find, later scientists found, right? It's because of this principle. Yeah. Very clever, isn't it? We can even predict what is going to be there because of it, because the permanence principle allows us to do this. Now, who did I have next? Did I have anybody next? No. Okay, can we go to Sandra? Where are you? Down here. And on the other side, Patricia, where's Patricia? You're on that side too. So we'll go from Sandra to Patricia. Yep, Sandra.
Sorry, which question? Because I had a
look. Oh, Sandra. Your very first one.
I think, is it what is true obedience?
That's the one.
Uh-huh. What is true obedience, and is it possible that we can obey God's laws without having received God's love?
Well, you already know the answer to the second part of the question. Is it possible to obey God's laws without having received God's love? Of course it is. The law of gravity is one of God's laws.
Oh, yeah.
And you obey it.
Yeah.
And you have, if you haven't received God's love, you obey it. And if you receive God's love, you still obey it. Right? So the reality is it is possible to obey God's laws. Remember, every law is God's law. So even all these physical laws, all the laws that control your body, you're obeying most of them. Otherwise, your body wouldn't be, you'd still be alive. So you're obeying most of those laws. There's quite a few billion of those that you're obeying.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, but even like what about the ones, you know, related to our souls?
Ah, well, that's different, isn't it?
And love and truth.
Yeah. Yeah, that's different, isn't it? Because that depends upon your desire and your current will state and so forth. Now, that's where we make most of our problems, isn't it? You know, physically, quite easy to obey the laws, and we don't even think of it as obeying the law, do we? It's almost like, no, that's the fact of life, and we just fit in with it, right? But when it comes to spiritual and soul-based things, we don't see it the same way. We sort of see like, no, I've got a choice here. I can disobey if I want to. I should be able to get away with it, you know? Like, so we start exercising this desire-based choice, and the problem with that, of course, is that's where we get our pain. Right, so physically we don't do it, and this is, remember, if you rewind right back to our first group, we talked about will, and then we raised the issue of faith. And remember, I said to most of you, well, most of you have complete faith in a lot of physical things. You know, you imagine if you had no faith in the mobile phone, would you have bought one? You wouldn't waste any money on it, would you? You go, I've got no faith in that. I'm not going to use that. It was stupid. How dare anybody stupidly think that you can ring up somebody and talk to them? What idiots, you know? If you had that concept of a mobile phone, what would happen? You wouldn't buy one, would you?
No.
You wouldn't rely on it, would you? You wouldn't take it with you everywhere you go, would you? Because it would all be unreliable, so you think. So you've got to have some faith, right, for things to change or to even use something that has been developed. And what I'm saying is that we have quite a large amount of faith in the physical thing that gets created, which is still, like, inside of a mobile phone, there are thousands of God's laws being obeyed to create the device.
So God knew we were going to create mobile phones.
Well, God allowed the possibility for us to create a mobile phone, just like God allowed the possibility for us to create anything in between the scope and the hierarchy and other principles that we have that govern the creation of such devices. But what I'm suggesting to you is, if you believe that this didn't work, you would not rely on it. And this is our problem as a soul-based entity. We can believe things that are not true, and therefore we will not rely on them as a natural consequence. So I feel the truth is, you can obey. You are already obeying a lot of physical laws. You're capable of obeying them, and you don't even question the obedience of them. But when it comes to emotional and spiritual laws, moral and ethical laws, you question inside of you every one of them. It's like, what's he saying? He's telling me that I've got to love somebody who wants to hurt me? What's an idiot like that saying that for? You know, that's you questioning an ethical belief that God has as a part of his principles that you don't have or you don't want to have because of fear, and you choose to disobey it. Does that make sense to you?
Yes.
Yeah. So when it comes to, is it possible to obey God's laws without having received God's love? Yes, for certain it is. And in fact, that's expected of you even after you pass it, to get to the sixth sphere of the spirit world, the love, the perfect natural man condition, you must have obeyed quite a lot of laws even though you have not received God's love.
So you're not even aware of it a lot of the times that you're obeying these laws.
No, but you do. Most six-sphere spirits are aware they are. They, in fact, many of them in the Paget messages you see when they come to talk, they say, I discovered the law that I have to treat every person equally. So they know it's a law and they discovered it. And once they discovered it, that's what they started doing, treating every person equally. So they started obeying it. But they didn't need God's love in their heart to do it. They just chose to do it.
Yeah.
So that's true, you can choose. Of course, it's far better to get God's love and the soul-based understanding because you obviously then have an expanded experience, which we'll talk about later when it comes to transformation, redemption, desire and those principles. Yeah, good
awesome.
Question.
Thank you so much.
Now, the next one was Patricia, wasn't it? Mm-hmm. Yep, thanks, Patricia.
I have three.
Far away. Question number one, sorry.
Oh, okay. Yep. How do the permanence principles apply to our souls? Because obviously they do change.
Well, yes, the soul has the ability to change, the potential to change. But without the permanence principles, that potential would not be the same under all circumstances. So the reality is the permanence principles say that if you have this level of desire, which is a frequency, emotional frequency, you have this level of desire and this amplitude, a certain thing is going to happen. If you have a bigger amplitude, even bigger things will happen. The permanence principle defines that, but the soul engages its desire and then engages that law that allows for that change to occur. So in fact, change would not be predictable without the permanence principle. Now that we have the permanence principle, change is predictable. If you engage a certain thing, a certain result will happen. Right? So an example of that is in the medicine field. You could say, you know, that device that I talked about where you dial in, is it breast cancer or bowel cancer or whatever else, and a certain frequency comes out. Now, we could make such devices because emotions are able to be predicted in terms of what happens to them. And this law determines that for us. So now we can predict what might happen in the future for a person by measuring the emotion that they have, if we had such a device, measure the emotion they have, and we could say, now you've got this specific emotion that causes this particular illness. If you need to address that emotion, otherwise you're going to get this illness. Right? You'll be able to predict that. Right? And in some ways the doctors do that now, don't they? They say, oh, you've got precancerous cells in your uterus and it's because, you know, and we need to remove them, but they don't understand how those precancerous cells turn into cancer or why they do. They just understand you have them, and that's the note that there's something further that might happen in the future. And what I'm suggesting is you can go much further than that. You can actually measure it based on the spiritual and emotional, the love-based. Remember, spiritual is the love-based and the emotional is the other emotions that flow. Inside of the soul, you can actually predict all of that as well. But nothing would be predictable without permanence.
Thank you.
Yep. Now next, if we can go to... Okay, I've done those. I should be marking these off, sorry, but Paige, where are you, Paige? If we go to your question number one, and Nikki... Where are you, mate? Down the front here, right in front of me. I shouldn't ask where you are. You'll be afterwards, thanks, with your two, question two. Thanks, Paige.
With regards to God's concept, God's laws are self-enforcing and always observe the attitudes, feelings and actions. Could you explain with examples how God observes, what that means and how it relates to the permanence principle?
Sure. Okay, so let's... Remember, our whiteboard is the infinite God. Remember that? Our Father and Mother. Let me just get rid of this. And where do we exist? Paige? Inside the infinite. We are finite, aren't we? Existing inside the infinite. So here's the infinite God, and there's got layers and layers of things in there, and right, drill down into the layers. And we're not a long way down in the layers because you've got infinitesimally small particles, and you've got small particles, and then you've got particles, and then you've got elemental atomic level structures, subatomic level structures, atomic level structures, and elements, and then you've got and so forth and so forth. And you build all that up, and it ends up that your body, your physical body, is the highest physical thing in this physical universe, except for your spirit body, which is the highest actually physical thing in the physical universe. So the reality is, right from the smallest particle, there's already millions and millions of combinations of things going on to create you. So already the human body being able to maintain itself, have a structure, and even have the soul connect to it has to all be defined mathematically, right? And as a result of that, you can have a connection and therefore be able to manipulate what the body does through the soul. and these things are all going on automatically. So we are very high in the food chain, I suppose you would call it. Not that I'm suggesting you eat everything below you. All right, so here we go. So we've got us, us down here. We're still quite small in the infinite, are we not? You know, if we look at our physical body, then we've got our spirit body, which is much bigger again, but still within the infinite. Then we've got our soul that encapsulates not only those two bodies, but also the female ones. And sorry about that being a bit smaller, it was just out of scale. Right? And the soul encapsulates those in a different dimension, but it encapsulates. So we've got these bodies being controlled by the soul. And Paige's question is, how could you explain how God observes what's going on in the thoughts, feelings and actions of the person? How does he observe it? What happens? That's what she's asking. All right. Now, I've already given you the secret to the answer, which is God is the most sensitive measuring instrument of the flow of energy. All right. Now, that actually answers almost any question you can ask if you think about it. But let's look at how that works. This person here, let's magnify you up so you're actually this big now. Right? So here you are. Right? You have a feeling. A feeling is an E energy in motion. Right? Even if it's a sensory feeling, it's still energy in motion. Even if it's just a thought, it's still an energy, a type of energy in motion. Each energy has its own frequencies that can be measured, and the amplitude of each energy can also be measured. So now we have an energy in motion. Now, if God is the most sensitive of measuring instruments of the flow of energy, and all of God's laws, in fact, are all measuring the flow of energy, right? Then you can see that you just have to have just a tiny little thought, spark of one, bang. And God's going to be able to measure that. As I said, you can have a hair drop out. So the energy is lost. In that moment, the hair dies. God's measured that. Does that make sense? Yeah. And every single thing in God's universe, God can measure because it's all happening inside of God. He doesn't have to go, what's going on over there? He's going, what's going on in here? Right? And he's so sensitive that he knows everything that's going on in there. And he's created laws that actually, and it's all mathematical, of course, he's created laws that can measure and sense that particular flow. And then the law, interestingly enough, has all hierarchy, governance and responsibility and compensation and all these other principles are all engaged in this law. So that means God can go, okay, if that particular thing goes, that particular motion flows to that intensity, there's going to be this result for that person in particular. Yeah. Does that make sense to you, Paige?
Thank you.
So he's measuring the flow of energy that passes through you or that comes from you. Yes. And in fact, he does that with every single thing from the most smallest particle to the greatest creation, which is the human soul. The whole universe is all governed the same way. God measures everything going on in the whole universe, all happening inside of the infinite.
And so, because of the permanence principle,
mm-hmm.
That's why he can do all those things.
Yeah, you imagine if anger was one day it was one frequency and one day it was the next frequency, and he says, right, I'm going to apply a compensation to your anger, and you go, but I wasn't angry, I felt love. And he goes, oh, so you did. Today it's different. he doesn't do that, right? So what he does instead is the frequency is the same, identical for each person, for each thing, and that way the law can be applied permanently each time for each situation, for each thing, and it's all measurable from God's perspective. Now, if the permanent principle wasn't there, you can see that, man, it would be pretty hard, because one day you'd have one measurement, and one day you have another measurement for the same thing, and someone would have to start working out, you know, was it this or was it that? And this is what would make God's life very difficult, if you think about it. You know, it'd be an impossible situation, wouldn't it, to create billions and billions and billions of children, and only to find that you can't measure any of them and can't know what's going on for any of them, right? Which sounds a bit like we do. But anyway, that's just an aside. Okay? Does that make sense to you,
Paige? Yeah, thank you.
Yep, so you get what's going on there? Okay. And we were Nikki next. So we're down the front, and it was your second question, Nikki.
Okay. If we can feel and have faith that the permanence principle is within all of God's laws, does that help us make the shift from self-reliance to God-reliance?
Yeah, really good question, Nikki. What Nikki's asking is, like, if we really believed in this principle, can you see that we'd really probably have a lot more faith in God, that we can rely on God, if we really believed the principle? Can you see that? Yeah. Because the permanence principles say, basically, that every single thing that happens is predictable, and therefore, if you think about it, God's feelings coming from God will be predictable, right? Which doesn't that help us greatly to know that God's feelings for us are going to be quite predictable in the end? Yeah. Of course it helps us a lot, yeah. Understanding this principle is a key component of many future principles. All of the foundation principles, we're calling them foundation principles for a reason, right? And the reason, of course, is that the other principles, when we get to order, and the principles when we get to the soul specific principles, they all build on these foundations. And can you see this? If permanence wasn't in the foundation, the whole structure would be a mess, wouldn't it? Like, one day it'd be one way, one day it'd be the other. There'd be no observable, measurable, quantifiable things going on in the universe at all. Everything would be unpredictable. What's the point of being a scientist? You might as well give that job up, do something else, wouldn't you? Yeah. There'd be no such thing as scientists, because they rely on things being measurable and permanent. You know, there's a lot of jobs that we currently have, on, even on Earth, that would be unable to be engaged. You wouldn't be able to create a phone. Unfortunately, Google Dave's place has stopped. Let me just... my time has gone. Oh, fortunately, I got this now. Yeah. Anyway, I'll get Mary to sort that out when we get back. Okay, so you know, with God stuff, it just keeps going, doesn't stop, keeps supplying the same principles right across the board. And permanence gives us this feeling of safety and security as a result. Yeah. Trust, it's wonderful when you think about it. Without permanence, there's no trust, right? No trust, no safety, no security. Man, life would be pretty unbearable, actually. Yeah, on a physical level, it would be unbearable and unsustainable, actually. Like I said, one day you'd walk out with gravity and you'd be walking on the ground, and the next day you're flying off in outer space. Like, you know, that's how unchangeable things would be if permanence didn't apply. So this order and structure is required in the system for you to be able to trust the system and also measure the system, but also order and structure is required for you to be able to learn. Because if one day things are different to the other day, what can you learn? Yes. You might as well give up learning. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so God designed this so that we could learn, trust, be safe, all those things. Mm. Powerful principle, isn't it?
Cheers, bro.
Okay. Pierre, 1 and 3, Pierre, thank you.
So, in the development principles, it is mentioned that law can evolve while laws are unchangeable and permanent. Can you please clarify?
Did we say that the law could evolve? Didn't we say in development principles that all matter can evolve?
I think I read law, creation,
Well, laws can be created, but the laws once created don't evolve. The creation can evolve. Development principles allow for the law to, the law allows for creation to evolve, but it doesn't allow for the law to evolve. New laws must be created rather than a law, a current law evolving. Does that make sense? The way you, new laws get created, we'll explain in the scope principles, but the reality is that new laws get created, new laws do not evolve, but creatures can evolve because they have laws that allow for evolution to occur. Does that make sense to you? So don't get the two mixed up. It's interesting you raise the question because the same question was asked in the first group. So I've given the answer twice. You'll be able to compare the answers. My answer to you is a little different to the first group. Both of the answers are true, so might pay to have a look at both of those. Question number three. Thanks, Matty.
Are all laws measurable, quantifiable, and observable by human in our current condition?
Now, that's sort of like what Wayne answered before, wasn't it? And the answer to that question, so are all laws quantifiable, measurable, and observable by human in the current condition? Well, obviously not, because you, there's things you don't know how you could measure things. But the potential of your measurement, that's different. Yes, all laws are potentially able to be measured. You've just got to get to the knowledge of how to do it, and then you can do it. Does that make sense? It's like at the discovery of any new law, you've got to first discover how, and once you've discovered how, then you can do. Right? And that applies to all of the laws that we've yet to discover. And by the way, how many laws are there?
Infinite.
So how many laws have we yet to discover?
Infinite.
Yeah, it's quite a lot, right? So there's actually scientists on Earth who believe that we've hardly got anything left to discover. And I would suggest to them that, yes, they're way off there. Given the fact, given the infinity principle, it's impossible for there to be hardly any laws left to discover on a physical or spiritual or emotional level. G'day. Well, we might, I think I've got, Pierre, I've answered you. So that answer was okay with you, Pierre? Rui, you would like to ask something related to that? You want to have your question asked, is that what you're saying? No, I don't think so. You cheeky, cheeky, cheeky man. Yeah. Monique, can we go to your question? Where are you? Thank you.
How does the permanent principles help me develop a relationship with God in trust and faith?
Yes, so you can see we've partially answered that already, but let's look at the two issues of trust and faith and look at what they are as emotions. Trust is basically that somebody has proven to you over and over and over and over and over and over and over again that they are consistent. Does that mean? That's what causes you to trust, isn't it? So now I'm not talking about trust that's unwarranted here. So unfortunately, many of you have unwarranted trust. And what that means is you trust people that have never proven to you that they're trustworthy. Right? Now, I'm not suggesting that that is real trust. That's just hope. So there's a big difference between some qualities that we need to take consideration of here in the answer. And one is we have hope. Hope is that usually associated with the fact that we hope somebody will do something. We hope they'll be trustworthy, you know. But that's different than real trust. Trust is the emotion that I know I can trust the person because hundreds of times before in my interactions with them, they have proven themselves to be reliable, they've proven themselves to be basically permanent, that they're trustworthy. Now, trust is different to faith, because trust is all about what's happened in the past. Faith is all about what you desire for your future. Right? So they are very, very different emotions, right? They might sound the same, but they're actually quite different. And they have different frequencies, of course. You know, One is based on past experience. The other is based on what you think and believe in your whole soul will happen in the future. Now, sometimes that's based on what's happened in the past, but the reality is it can also be based on suppositions and assumptions, or it could be based on something that's actually true. So, for example, if I have faith in God's goodness, I could have faith in God's goodness without having any trust in God yet, couldn't I? Because faith in God's goodness is about my desire for the future. I desire to put some faith in God's goodness. While at the moment, I might not have any experience with God's goodness and therefore have no trust of it yet. Can you see that? Right? But this principle allows me, if I understand everything God has done is permanent, everything is quantifiable, everything is measurable, everything is able to be mathematically stable, it's a mathematically stable, it's going to be identical in operation each time, then I can flirt with desire, which is having a faith for the future, while at the same time having no trust because of what's happened in the past. So in other words, I start to believe, you know, I start to have some faith that God is good. Even though at the moment I don't really trust God is good, I can start to have some faith that God is good because of the principle. Then I gain some experience through my personal engagement of that principle. And then I have some past experience, which means I now start to trust. Besides just having faith that God is good, I now know, I have trust now that God is good because I've had experience with God being good. Does that make sense to you, Monique? Mm. Yeah. So while the question might seem very simple, it's actually interesting because one emotion looks at past experiences, and as we said right at the first assistance group, most of us have yet to have had a past experience with God. Hence, we yet to have not much trust, but that's not an excuse to not have faith, which is actually the future-based desire. So most of us think it is, you see. What most of us do is we go, my past experience is going to determine my future experience. Right? But that doesn't have to happen with God, and we can see that if we start seeing that, my past experience is with love is really all about human love. And we're basically saying, when we don't trust or have faith, we're basically saying that God's love is going to respond the same way that human love does. That's really what we're saying inside of us. Right? But once we understand this principle, we go, human love is not permanent. They can love me one day and not love me the next day just because I did something that they didn't like, right? But God doesn't do that. God loves us permanently, and God also gives us feedback when we're out of harmony with the law, but that doesn't mean he doesn't love us still. He still loves us permanently, right? And this allows us to start having faith that God is good and God wants to give God's love to us. You follow? So it's a very key part of developing your relationship with God, obviously, even though you don't have much trust at this stage.
Yeah.
Thank you. G'day. Well, that brings us to the conclusion of the permanence principles. As I said, we now have a break. If we could come back at 5 to 2. Yep. And hopefully it's just 3 minutes shy of 30 minutes for your lunch break. And we'll get on with the scope principles. Thanks, guys. Thank you.